And welcome to the session. In a way, I feel a bit guilty of taking you away from the bazaar, but I promise I'll try to compensate that with a very sharp overview of what has happened in Clarin, technically speaking, in the last year. And I'll also try to sneak in some local pictures from Wrocław. If you Google for Wrocław and dwarves, you will find a lot of explanations about it, but you'll see they have invaded somehow my presentations. Okay. So, where are we standing today? Of course, in Clarin, it's all about the centers and the distributed infrastructure. And I took this picture actually yesterday from the center registry. And so far, we have 32 registered Clarin centers. As you can see, it's getting more and more distributed. Last year, it was still a bit situated in the center of Europe. We're expanding. And there was actually a small technical problem this year because we have our first American center at Carnegie Mellon University. So I tried to put it in the additional map on the site. And I hope actually that I will have this luxurious problem more and more over the next years because centers might pop up in other parts of the world as well. And actually we're actively looking forward to that. Maybe in addition to this, it's also interesting to tell you that just this week, one of the Clarin centers has received the news that their collection or part of their collection has become immaterial cultural heritage at the UNESCO list. And that's basically part of the archive of the language archive, so the MPI in Nijmegen, which has officially received that kind of recognition. And I think that's very telling for the value of data which we are actually storing and holding in the Clarin centers. And I think it's absolutely a very good good sign. Okay, so some more details on the Clarin centers. What has happened over the last years? Well, we have had, as you have seen explained by Lene, we have had some B center assessments and three new centers on the map, which have achieved the B center status. So it's a full scale check in terms of the requirements that both hold that the center has achieved the data seal of approval, but also is fully Clarin compliant. Think of component metadata, persistent identifiers, shibboleth login to the protected resources. It's all integrated. First center, as I said, is Talkbank at Carnegie Mellon University in the US. We have the Huygens ING in the Netherlands, and we have the local host here, actually, the Clarin PL Language Technology Center. And I really would like also to congratulate these centers with achieving this B center status. In addition to this, and Lena already mentioned it in her presentation, the nine German centers which kicked off the whole B center assessment cycle have gone through a successful reassessment. And I think in a way that's also a very good sign. It's giving hope for the future of Clarin that the centers which have made it possible to get up to the level of a B center are also in the ability to continue that effort. Very important in an infrastructure like Clarin. We've been talking about A center assessment procedures over the last couple of days. And as Lena already explained in her talk, we will be piloting those A centers in the course early 2016. All in all, we have currently 19 Clarin centers which are open for data deposition. So if you, as a user, as a humanities researcher, want to deposit a language resource data set, you can go to 19 Clarin centers, look which one suits the best, the kind of resource that you would like to deposit, and then upload it, ingest it in one of these repositories. Again, this information is available on the website under clarin.eu, and if you click through to services, you will find the overview of the depositing services. So let me take the opportunity also to thank the assessment committee, Lene, Patrice, Tobias, Daan, Thomas, and Josef, which are doing obviously a very good job in helping us to keep up the quality of standard that we need to have at the Clarin centers. A very important job. It's often a bit in the background. You don't see so much immediate results other than the final assessment outcomes, but it's a very important thing to keep up the quality inside Clarin, and therefore really thankful to these people. So, next point, the Identity Federation. This is the overview of last year again. So, as you know, Clarin tries to provide single sign-on to language resources in case they are password protected. We've basically listed all federations inside Europe and we've given them a color. If they are green, it means that Clarin has basically connected to these federations, so users from these countries can access Clarin services. If they are blue, the connection has been planned, and if they are black, it is a federation in Europe, but they're not yet on our implementation list. Now, ideally, of course, in the end, we want to cover all of these federations in order to make sure that all these users do get access to Clarin services. So where are we standing at this point, 1 year later? So, as you can see, Austria has been added, Sweden has been added, Slovenia has been added, and the UK Federation has also been added. There are a few new members which have gotten into the Clarin family in the meantime. So obviously we have also marked them for inclusion into the Clarin Federation. And actually we have now agreed that we will try in a period of about 2 years to include all of these federations. This is also a part of Clarin Plus. We will come back later to that, but this just to prove that we are in this respect also very ambitious, but I think it is also an absolute necessity so that we can make sure that we can reach out broadly to the user base, which is spread all over Europe and even outside there. Some numbers. Basically, if you put this together and you look at the number of institutes per country which is connected, you get this table. And as you can see, we are currently reaching out to more than 900 identity providers, so universities, departments of universities, where potential users are situated. Last year, just to give a comparison, we had 430 identity providers, something like that. As you can see, obviously, this is also through the inclusion of some of the larger countries, like the UK, which brings along lots of potential users. But I think, all in all, it's a very good sign that we see this number raising. And it's just not only about numbers. I mean, what we are also actively doing is checking these kind of connections. We're test driving whether people can really log in, whether there are not any small problems. And there are enough potential problems, I can tell you. But in that respect, we're really doing also our best to give a quality insurance on the login procedures. Again, Clarin Plus will really help us in that, and we're actively working on making the whole login experience even better. Okay, so let's go back then to some of the services and some of the tools which are available through the central Clarin level, and what has been done with them over the last year. A very important central part of the Clarin infrastructure is the center registry. This is, so to say, our central database. If you are a Clarin center, the authoritative information is stored in the Clarin center registry. More than just making it look prettier, because that was done this year, and now it is more in line with kind of general Clarin styling, we've worked a lot on better integration of the Clarin Center Registry with some of the other components in Clarin. I have illustration of that on this slide. Basically, as you can see, at the bottom of this page, there is the Center Registry. And now, as soon as certain services are entered or centers are entered in the Center Registry, there is an automated connection to many of the other parts of the infrastructure. So when you enter your harvesting endpoint or your federated content search endpoint in the center registry, immediately the monitoring gets triggered and an automatic checking procedure is initiated. That means that as soon as your server goes down or you're not compliant to the protocol anymore, both you and someone at Clarin ERIC office will be informed about that. We're also keeping records of this, so we will be able at the end of the year to see how much uptime your service had. And I think it's very important in terms of the total end experience for the end users that this kind of integration is made. It also helps everyone. It makes the life easier, for instance, also of the assessment committee if automated checks like this are in place. Second example, if you enter your OAI PMH endpoint, so your metadata harvesting endpoint in the center registry, automatically the harvester will start harvesting the metadata from your center. It will then, afterwards, be automatically ingested into the virtual language observatory. And again, that means that many steps that used to be manual are eliminated from the process, and these kind of things are really going smoothly and automated now. I think it's very helpful. Similarly, for the federated content search, if you enter your endpoints in the center registry, after a while, it will be possible to use the federated content search to search through your local data. This is just a beginning point, but I think it's very illustrative for the importance of the whole integration of Clarin. And I think where so far we have been much working on setting up these separate modules or services, the next couple of years will really be a matter of making sure that everything works together, gets integrated, and that we get this kind of smooth end-user experience, both for you in the centers, but also for the end-user community. A next service which has been quite reworked is actually the federated content search aggregator, as it's called. It's a content search engine. As you can see, if you compare it to what we had last year in terms of user interface, things have been much improved in terms of getting things more stylish and also much more user-friendly. This is also, again, available through the Clarin EU website on the services. You can click through to the content search and then see what kind of information is available. Now, this is just the first step. So this is still based on a fairly basic first version of the federated content search protocol that we have introduced a few years ago. In a few slides, I'll come back to the more future versions of this, where it really will get exciting in terms of the search capabilities. Again, this gives also a bit of an idea how a unified Clarin style could look like. It's not a final thing yet. This is also something which we will take up in Clarin Plus, working on the styling, on a kind of user interface guidelines, and then making sure that this is also in a harmonized way implemented in the Clarin services. Okay, another service, the Virtual Language Observatory. It was also part of the bazaar I saw. And actually, we've had some iterations in the whole development of the Virtual Language Observatory. And although you might not see it in the interface, I mean, the interface has largely stayed the same. It will also be taken up in the whole restyling steps that we will be taking for the Clarin services. But a lot has happened actually in the back end. I think I really need to thank Thomas, Davor, and Twan here for doing a lot of very good work in the back end, because as you can see now, and actually it's demonstrated, I'm not sure if it's possible to read it from your chair, but the search functionality has improved a lot. It's now possible to use more powerful queries, and also in terms of the scoring, a lot has been improved. And quite soon, a feature will also be opened up, which will be able to show hierarchies in the collections. And I think that's also a very important point of feedback that we have received from the users, from the VLO task force, from the metadata curation task force, that the point of granularity really needs to be taken in account through this hierarchies, which will be integrated into the VLO, that will, I think, largely be addressed. It's, of course, always something that needs to be still improved, where we also really greatly appreciate your feedback to our application. So please keep on sending us emails and keep on reporting issues that you see. We cannot improve it without your feedback. But as you will see, also with these hierarchies, things have improved and will improve quite a lot. Okay, something a bit about the work behind the scenes, because these are, so to say, the user-facing applications, but a lot of the infrastructure is also happening in not such a visible way. So therefore, quick overview of what has been happening behind the scenes. So first of all, we have been migrated the IsoCat definitions to an OpenSchools-based Clarin concept registry, which is now curated by the Clarin Concept Registry coordinators. There will be a presentation about this tomorrow, so I will not go into the details of this. Secondly, work has been done on the metadata component registry, which needs another front end. I mean, some of the technology that was used to program it got outdated. And thanks to some of the work of Mitchell Seaton and Tuan, this is now being ported to a more modern age technology, which also will make it possible to do the maintenance of the component registry in a more fluent way. The metadata harvester has been largely rewritten, thanks to Menzo, who has done a lot of work on this. Again, this is something which is fairly invisible to you as a user of the VLO, but to the total robustness of the infrastructure, it means a lot, and I think that has been a very good thing. We have had a workshop on persistent identifiers, basically after some of the Clarin centers came up with a question about the use of data side DOIs within the Clarin infrastructure. And we've been basically talking about the issues there, seen some very interesting presentations. We've made a summarizing document about the potential use of DOIs in the Clarin infrastructure, and this has been made available. I think very important part also that from our side of the infrastructure that we also keep a look at the landscape, which things are changing, or maybe new technologies are coming up. We should make sure that we stay up to date with these and that we also can give clear recommendations on use of new or upcoming technologies. There is the usability and stability improvements to the discovery service. So when you log into one of the password protected Clarin services, you get a list of organizations through which you can log in. It might seem like a very trivial part of the whole endeavor, but it is a very frequently used part of our services. And it's also something which is very important in terms of the usability. If you as a user cannot find your university because the system doesn't recognize that you're using an umlaut or so, that really can scare users away because they think, well, it's not working. So this is really something where we need to focus on the usability. We have done so. Lots of things have been improved in the back, and it will also be taken up in the next couple of months for further improvement. But I think that also this discovery service has gotten a much higher reliability and especially usability over the last years. And then something about statistics. I heard Martin mentioning the fact that we need to count and that we need to get a better overview about what we're actually providing, how many users are there, from where do they come, how do they get from one service to the other, through the use of a system like Pweek, which is basically a system to track visits to services. We have now made available one central service, which is not obligatory, but it's a service towards the Clarin centers, which makes it possible to track the users to some of the services. Okay, something related with the work behind the scenes is actually this slightly outdated, I think, overview of the license types in Clarin. So this is actually the outcomes of a questionnaire that we have done 2 years ago, basically asking the centers about the proportion of the academic, public, restricted resources at their centers. This was something manual. I think what we ideally would like to achieve, and this was also discussed in detail at the metadata curation task force yesterday, is that we should be able to calculate or to get this kind of information automatically from the metadata. And we're slowly but certainly getting there. I mean, there are now profiles which are supporting this information. It has been mapped to the Virtual Language Observatory. Now, the big challenge is, of course, making sure that the metadata at the centers is being updated and includes this kind of information. So I've included this as a kind of hopefully something which we in the future will be able to generate automatically. Something just working behind the scenes because everything is well integrated. It's not there yet, but we hope to have it ready relatively short term. Again, this really depends also on the goodwill and the cooperation of the centers. Given the experiences from the past, I'm hopeful. Okay, migration and mobility. Last year at the conference, lots of questions were asked about services that potentially would need to be migrated. A service needs another technical environment, a center gets another profile, and thus sometimes it is necessary to migrate a service from one center to the other. We have devoted quite a lot of attention to this, also because this was, for instance, one of the feedback points that we have received from the ESFRI assessment board and also from our scientific advisory boards in earlier years. So we have been focusing on it quite a lot, and we've been looking at technologies like Docker containers to be able to make services more easily deployable at other locations. So this means where it used to be often the case that the service was running at the center, well managed by a system administrator over there, but at the point where you needed to migrate the service to another center, there were lots of potential problems. Is there enough documentation? Is there a clear description of what kind of technical environment you need? Maybe there is some specific know-how that you would need to migrate the service from one place to the other. Now, Docker is, I wouldn't say the universal answer to all these kind of things, but it is a very useful mean in order to make the description of such a service far more explicit. So it basically asks to someone who creates a container to make explicit statements about what kind of operating system is needed, what kind of libraries are needed to run specific services, etc., etc. And the nice thing is, it is executable. So it basically means that if you, as a system administrator, are asked to run a specific service on your center, that you basically can run a script and that Docker in the backend automatically puts together the whole environment where this service needs to be run. Again, this is not the total perfect solution to everything, but it's a very good mean to get towards a higher mobility. And I think it is also, in many aspects, a key to the flexibility and to the robustness of the technical infrastructure of Clarin. And just to illustrate this, many of the services have been migrated over the last year to other centers. If everything went well, and I think it did, you shouldn't have noticed it, but the migrations have taken place. So for instance, a component registry is now running at another server, same for the discovery service. For the developers, the Maven repository has been migrated, the virtual language observatory has been migrated, and all these migrations have also been combined with Dockerization of the Clarin services. Finally, about the mobility and migration, I think we've had quite a good number of successful mobility grants. Basically, a developer or someone from a center going to another center, maybe several people sitting together, exchanging information about either services or Clarin repositories. And I think it really has helped. So this is a kind of small travel money from Clarin Eric for the developers to move from one center to another, stay there 1 or 2 weeks, a few days maybe, to exchange information. This has made it possible, I think, in great extent also to set up many repositories at some of the new member countries. And I think it is it's a very successful mean to stimulate the mobility and also to, in the end, make sure that our knowledge infrastructure, the sharing of the knowledge, really gets to work. Okay, finally, something about our integration into the infrastructure landscape. It's a fairly generic overview that you can see here, but as we have presented that at earlier presentations also, Clarin is not alone in the world. So we're collaborating with different of the infrastructural layers from the network level, Géant, up to the data centers, large computing centers through EUDET, in connection with RDA about how to set up all this infrastructure, how to set up the connections with the e-infrastructures like EUDET, with sister infrastructures like Daria, and of course also with researchers. Rather than explaining this generic schema, I'll give you a few examples to just illustrate how we are collaborating with these infrastructure partners. For instance, EUDET, where we are now also part of the EUDET 2020 project. There we are harvesting the metadata part for the language resource community from B2Share. It is available in the VLO, you can find it there. We're going to set up a training workshop about IROTS, or B2Safe, as it is called in the EUDET world, about safe replication. So basically giving technical means to the centers to replicate their data sets to some of the trusted large computing centers, including all kind of information about how long the data can be kept there and all kind of other policy information. 10 Clarence centers have expressed their interest to participate in this pilot, and we hope to have early December a training session and to start early 2016 with a real implementation at the Clarence centers. There are plans to integrate B2Drop, which is the kind of the cloud workspace storage from EUDET. It's own cloud based, and would be very exciting to integrate this into the Clarence infrastructure, where you can basically upload something into a workspace, maybe share it with a few colleagues, and then send it off to one of the Clarence services to be processed or even ingested in one of the Clarence repositories. We're quite active also at the level of the Research Data Alliance. Just some of the working groups or interest groups where we are active, the legal interoperability. There's a working group that recently was started on virtual collections. We're also basically active in the working group on Data Fabric, which is a bit of the architectural overview of the RDA, so which fits quite well with our model of how we are storing things in the repositories, registering the data, etc. Finally, we're also quite actively working with the Europeana folks. There we have, for instance, run a test import of the metadata records from Europeana into the Virtual Language Observatory. So that's also something you can expect to see in the next maybe couple of months, early 2016, to see the metadata records from the library world to appear in the Virtual Language Observatory. And that's thanks to the colleagues from the BBAW, so Axel and Susanne and Christian, we've been working on the closer and tighter integration of historic newspaper corpora that are hosted at Europeana in the Clarence infrastructure through, for instance, creation of a specific metadata profile for such data and through actually also inspection of the data quality, feedback on the OCR results, etc. Stay tuned, we will have some more information about that in the next time. Okay, what's coming up? So really finishing now. Short overview about what the main things that are planned for the upcoming year, or the major important things which will be happening at the technical side, of course. First of all, a lot of work is currently being done by Leif Joran and Oliver on the new, and of course the whole Federated Content Search Task Force, on a new protocol for the Federated Content Search. This will bring CQP-alike query possibilities to the Federated Content Search. So where so far you were just restricted to plain text, it will be possible to search for a specific part of speech or a lemma, combine this, and then have the search being performed over different search engines. There's also work being done on the new component metadata framework, which will also help greatly to get to a higher metadata quality through, for instance, the inclusion of semi-controlled vocabularies. SIMD 1.2, it's on its way, and the people from the SIMD task force are working hard on it. There is a new system foreseen for the Clarence identity provider. We will migrate this to Unity IDM, which is basically also the solution which EUDET chose. And we'll do some extension to that to make it completely integrated into the Clarence infrastructure. There's the what I already mentioned, the unified styling and interface guidelines. So really trying to give a unified impression to the end users, and also a more pretty impression. Not that 15 different interfaces anymore, but at least some guidelines, some styling hints for the applications. Work is being done on the metadata curation framework. As you probably know, when you have taken a look at the VLO, there's a lot of work to do there. But the good news is that the work has started and that the first results are already visible in the VLO. So if you look there at, for instance, this availability facet, you can really see that some of the values have been cleaned up and are available in a more consistent way. And finally, I've put here documentation, because I think it is really also a key. We don't only need to create new modules or to improve them or to connect them, but we also need to document them. And I think that's also one very important pillar of Clarence Plus, is making clear what we are doing, how we are doing it, and giving best practices so that people don't need to reinvent the wheel, but can learn from each other, also through training, through video tutorials, etc., etc. But this is a very important thing, and we will definitely focus it in the next year. Okay, so that's it. Thank you for your attention. If you have any questions, I'll be glad to answer them.